general accounts that they simply manage, and that starts on page 143. Page 145. Page 146. Page 147. Okay, on 149, we're going into risk management. Risk management, page 149 and top of 150. 149 and top of 150. Group insurance and wellness, page 150 and 151. Go to page 272, is going to be the capital. Bottom of 272 and very top of 273. Lori, did we ever address that issue with SLCC and to Did we go back and check minutes? Do you have a response for me?
Yes, I believe you might not have received it yet. It was listed on one of the wrap-up items. That agreement is not applicable for the coming fiscal year, so if we don't plan on renewing that, we can remove that from the budget.
Would somebody please oblige? Line item 40117-4003-000170, SLCC proposed at $100,000. There's a general amendment to make that zero by Mr. Castile. Are there any objections? Mr. Kong?
It's not that I'm objecting, but do we have anything in the form of an agreement in place?
It was an agreement for a period of 1 or 2 years, and it's going to be in your wrap-up packet. If you haven't received it yet, you'll get a copy of the agreement, but it is expired, and it's not applicable for the next fiscal year.
Thank you. Then no objection to the amendment.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate that. You'd have done better if you'd have just listened to Mr. Castillo. No, but that, if you remember, that was an issue that kind of caught my eye. And I guess me and Mr. Castillo are only two who were here at the time, but it was agreement with SLCC, Lafayette Parish School System, and I think they secured some money from the state to enhance their nursing program and address some issues. And I recall a 1 year commitment, maybe with a 2 year option as described, but certainly not ongoing. And I'm glad we was able to catch that and address that issue. And I don't suggest that y'all do anything with that money. Not just yet. All right. We're going to move to the Manning table, page 299. Office of Finance and Management has indicated there's a decrease of two positions. Page 300. Okay, I don't see any questions. Anything closing, Laura?
Yes, I would like to. I probably should have introduced my staff. I was too much in a hurry to get it over with. But now that that's done, I'd like to introduce my staff. You know Melinda. Melinda is the controller. Kearney is the budget manager. We have our accounting manager, Tammy Andrews. We have our purchasing manager, Thomasina. We have our risk manager, Suzanne, our group health and wellness manager, Vicki. I have my staff, Emily Beard, my secretary, Laura, who works on those wonderful pie charts I know y'all are missing today. She does a lot of other things too. She's also John's wife, you know that. So, and then Connie here from the budget department, and the rest of my staff, y'all could stand up. We have Antonio, our operations supervisor. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. We will now move to the president's office.
The allocation for the president's office has been changed. It's been changed from one based on population to one based on non-dedicated ad valorem and sales tax revenue. There's no change in budgeted positions.
Okay. Mr. Robidoux.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know the protocol. Do I stay here or am I required to go to the podium? I don't want to do anything to aggravate the council, so I'll go wherever y'all tell me to go.
You know, is it? I remember a school board once put the superintendent out in the audience, but I would not dare do that to the mayor president.
Thank you.
You're fine where you're
at. All right. Let me just say a couple of things. It's important to know if you want to compare this proposed budget with the one that was adopted at this time last year. You need to remember that we abolished the chief development officer's position. So when you look at the budget, you would need to look at them in total. And so I ran the numbers that if you do that for personnel cost, we actually have reduced the budget from this time last year, $27,202. And then if you look at the non-personnel, we've reduced it from the budget that was adopted this time last year by $26,402. I guess what I'll do is I'm certainly happy to answer any questions that y'all may have. If there's any line items, rather than me go through it, I'll just wait for y'all to ask whatever questions come up, and I'm happy to answer them.
Okay. All right. We're going to go ahead on and start the review on page 131. We're going to start with the mayor president's office. Bottom of 131 and top of 132, that's the chief development officer, which has been zeroed out throughout. That's what he just referenced as has been eliminated. Go to the capital at 271. Lord, the security system improvements that are here, is that for City Hall or is that upstairs specifically for the mayor's office or?
No, it's for a camera system throughout City Hall in addition to the mayor's office and then some throughout the lobby and the foyer that we had gotten quotes for. Was there anything besides the camera system that's included in that number? I think right now it's just the camera system. I can tell you personally, if we come in under the budget, I would like to discuss with the council to see if it's possible to get a metal detector coming into the auditorium here. I just think in today's climate, it's you know something that we really do need to consider having. And
that's why I had asked is because there was previous discussion, and Veronica, chime in on this, please. There was some previous discussion that involved all the occupants of City Hall as it relates to security measures. Some things were considered, and that's where the security attendant, and that was created. There was some, but I'm If in fact we're moving forward on some security, and if there is a plan for the entire facility, I would like to consider maybe, even if it's over multiple years or phases, that we look at this now, especially in light of the fact that some previously budgeted money might have just became available for some capital to take on something, like you say, in today's climate and public meetings and other events. But because I know we had some concerns at the council office as well, especially, it's not as much probably, but we used to get a lot of visitors before that because we was the first stop. We was the first accessible place. But
Right. Discussions were held maybe a couple of years ago, and about a metal detector like they have at the courthouse. But I think at that time, the funding amount or the cost for the mechanisms to put in place were, you know, very expensive at the time, so they did not put it in the budget. But I think about a year and a half ago, we discussed the security guard, and since then, we've had that put in place for all of City Hall.
And Joe, the camera layout that is being proposed, I heard you say City Hall, but has there been any talk like with us? And I know civil service is kind of isolated. They kind of behind closed doors. But has a plan been laid out to kind of secure the
whole? Yeah, and I'm going off of memory, but the invoices, as I remember, there's going to be one that's kind of in the foyer that'll see everything from the front coming to towards the escalators and then to the bathroom. Then there's one somewhere in one of the corners upstairs. I know that. And then maybe the rest of the cost was associated with, actually, we didn't, Ariel, the receptions didn't even have a monitor for downstairs to see what was going on, if there was any activity downstairs that she needed to see to take herself out of harm's way. So I think it was some monitors to be placed in places that don't have it. But let me just say, I mean, that's what the security money's for. Mm-hmm. Like you mentioned, there may be some money that we found from capital outlay earlier tonight. I strongly believe that, you know, we can do it in phases. I think this auditorium needs to have some protection, and whether that's a metal detector and a part-time security guard for the three nights a month that we need it to be able, because you need to have someone there that can wand people if the alarm goes off and those kinds of things. But I feel like it's money well spent. We started discussions, and I probably have some crude numbers sketched out somewhere in my office on what the cost would look more like to do a more thorough protection of all of City Hall. And I think it was around $150,000 when you started talking about it all. But that's not too far from where we are. But certainly, like you say, if we phase it in over the next couple of years, I just want you to know that This is for the cameras, which is a start. And if we need to take it further, I'm certainly open to that and would love to have that conversation with the council to see if it's something we can do jointly.
Well, again, when it comes, you know, the visitors to our auditorium on meeting nights, those who are serving in official capacity, we have a great security team in place and plan, but you just can't have enough at times. And I would respectfully ask that if you could revisit your numbers between now and then, and, you know, maybe, again, an opportunity has now been presented without having to find new money, that maybe some things could be done that you maybe were setting aside and say, let's not do too much at one time. Well, now maybe we could do more.
I'll certainly put it in a little bit more of a formal presentation and get that sent over to the council for you guys to digest, and then we can go from there.
Mr. Castillo?
Yes. When I was chair a few years back, if you remember, I did a security study of City Hall, the whole thing with Chief Kraft at the time and the officers, and they came up with a plan of different security measures and cost. I need to find that. I'm giving it to Veronica, and we'll give it to Mr. Robidoux. It kind of broke down City Hall, and I mean, it went from one extreme to the
other. Right, because I think it looked at wands, just having wands, as opposed to
all kinds of different scenarios and doors. And so I'll try to find that study for you, and maybe you can tag it onto what you have, or maybe
that'd be great. I'll put it all out there, and then it's kind of be like a buffet, and we can all decide what we think, you know, we're all comfortable with, and then go from there.
Yeah. So, Veronica, if you don't mind, try to find that.
Yes, was that metal plate behind here and all of that stuff?
Well, that's when, I was, yeah.
I think I included something like
included
that in my analysis, too.
Yeah. There were some things that we had talked about.
Because I know they came and looked at to put panels all around here, and it wasn't a significant cost. So I'm thinking it's in Jim Groves' budget with Public Works, but I could call and I'll confirm that and let you know. But I think they did get cost estimates for the panels all the way around.
Yeah, we had got cost estimates for that.
And I think we did it again.
Recently they did it. So, they came here.
That's good.
Yeah, because, I'd had the meeting with
I think
with,
it may be included in this budget to put those panels.
Now, I don't remember if we actually took that step to put it in or not. But certainly he has the dollar amount.
Yes, sir, he does. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
I guess just for the record, try to get something to us for wrap-up. His and whatever Jadim find, but if Joel gets his notes together.
Yes, sir.
Page 297, the Manning table. Okay, seeing no questions. Chief Administrative Officer.
The CAO's allocation method has been changed from one based on population to one based on non-dedicated ad valorem and sales tax revenue in the city versus the parish general fund.
Mr. Duyon.
How you doing, Mr. Chairman?
I'm doing fine, sir.
Good. It's basically a status quo budget. It's up about $1,400. The majority of that, or at least half of it, is transportation costs, which we don't have much over. We did move around a few non-personnel cost items, but pretty much straightforward.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
We're on page 132. This particular department has a number of divisions within it, so we're going to go a division at a time to address this matter. Page 132, Administration CAO. Top of 133 as well, small portion on 133. Small Business Support Services, middle of 133. Still raining, Kyle? Bottom of 133 and top of 134, international trade.
Ladies and gentlemen of the council, thank you for your time today. If I understand correctly what happened last week, a member of the council proposed an amendment that would cut all of our parish funds, $95,000. From our budget, on the assumption that we serve the city and not the parish. So this is not accurate, and we prepared an information booklet for you today that Veronica is presenting to you, and I'm going to ask Dave Domingue to go over the contents very quickly.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, I'm Dave Domingue. I'm the International Center's operations coordinator. If you'll turn to the first page of the booklet that Ms. Williams just passed out, you'll see our organizational structure, and I'd like to introduce two other members of our staff who are present, Christophe Pilou, who is our information and translation specialist, and Vanessa Paredes, who is our international business specialist. We have two additional members who are at the building at this time. We have a total of six people on our staff. Five of them are in our budget. Vanessa is a presidential appointee, and she's in Mr. Robideau's budget. The next spread, the next two pages, will show you on the left our mission statement, and on the right, the page from last year's annual report, highlighting just some of the accomplishments that we did during the last fiscal year. As most of you know, our office was created when the oil slump hit Lafayette in the late 80s, and it was determined by the City Council at that time to take advantage of all of the cultural ties that the Lafayette region had based on the history of Coteauville, which was several decades old at that point and which was headed by Philippe Gustin, and take those ties and turn them into economic development ties to generate revenue for this region from fresh sources, sources in other countries. If you'll turn the page one more time, you'll see the history of the major events that we've done since that time. We've had a number of events that we've taken part in, a number of events that we've sponsored. We gather people from this area by sometimes by business sector, sometimes by specialized interest. We take them abroad to different parts of the world, and we introduce them to people that they have the potential of doing business with. And when contracts are signed through that means, through trade missions of that sort, or through reverse trade missions, when groups from other countries come here, that generates revenue for Lafayette Parish. On the right-hand side, you'll see just some of the seminars that we've offered to people to help them learn how to do business in other countries. Currently, we're focusing more and more on e-commerce and web internationalization. We do a number of projects in conjunction with LIDA, with LCVC, with the university. We also serve as Lafayette Consolidated Government's State Department. So if we have international visitors, last year we hosted two international conferences in Lafayette. One was a conference of international French-speaking mayors. We had 202 delegations take part in that conference. It was a tremendous economic hit for Lafayette, but it was also a chance to put Lafayette on the international stage and raise awareness of the culture and the heritage of our area. If you'll turn the page one more time, you'll see on the left a list of ongoing statistics. And if you look at the blue bar toward the bottom of the page, you'll see that last year, the financial impact of our efforts compared to the amount that was expended in our budget by consolidated government was a factor of 1 to 58.03. We generated $58 for every dollar spent on our division. The last year was an extraordinary year, and we'll be the first to admit that. But I do want to point out that as you look over those figures for the dollar impact that we are accounting for, this is the minimum account, the minimum amount that we can account for. The number of sales dollars and contract dollars that come to our attention, that information is given to us by the companies that we work with. And as I'm sure you can appreciate, in the private sector, not every business wants everybody else to know what their business is. So sometimes those figures are withheld from us. So this is only the amount that we have been assured we can make public. And we never make the names of the companies public, but these companies have been willing to share. That $58 for every dollar spent also includes tourism money. When people come to Lafayette from other areas because of the outreach that we've been doing for the past 27 years. On the right side of the page, you'll see how the sales contracts break down in terms of city and parish and the other incorporated areas inside the parish. So the contracts that we have historically account for 43% falling into the unincorporated area, 51% falling into the city area. And if I could ask you to turn the page one more time, you'll see a map showing the distribution of the companies that the International Center tracks. These are companies in Lafayette Parish that we feel have export potential or that have shown export potential. Some of these we're working with actively at any given point. Some we extend invitations to come to our seminars. We have interaction with them on varying levels. And another slightly complicating factor in our effort to maintain statistics is the fact that the addresses that we have for these companies are most frequently the addresses of their administrative offices, and a lot of those fall in the center of the parish, whereas their pipe yards, their warehouses, their manufacturing facilities fall in the rural areas, and those are the larger properties that are being paid property tax on. So statistically speaking, it's a slightly complicated process to track our influence, if you will. And the final two pages of our report are some of the testimonials that we have from people that we've worked with in the private, government, and educational sectors.
So thank you, Dave. Now you have information in front of you that show that all of the money you spend on this division is an investment. We generate wealth by helping companies sell their products and services overseas, about $55 million that we've been able to account for. But remember that most business executives are reluctant to sharing financial information, especially with a government agency, so it's probably a lot more than that, in fact. And then the tourism-related dollars we have, we are able to track the people we host in Lafayette ourselves, that we book hotels for and restaurants and rental cars. But it's also only the tip of the iceberg, because a lot of people come to Lafayette because of the good publicity or exposure or news we generate in other countries. Just today, for example, we have a band coming back from three festivals, the band Feu Follet, three festivals in Canada that we help arrange for. Major Handy, another performer for Lafayette, played in Washington, D.C. at the Embassy of France 2 months ago because of an event we organized there. So we generate a lot of activities, both in the business sector, in the tourism sector, as well as in the cultural sectors, artisans, musicians, artists, etc. So we'd like for you to consider that when you vote on this amendment next week. We feel that there would be a better way, a more fair way, to maybe find the money to fund the other thing that are very critical, and I sympathize with you. You do have to find that money somewhere. But that cut would cripple. You would basically destroy our agency to help another one. It would cripple, so we would have to eliminate at least two or three positions out of our budget. So we stand ready to help you find some of the money. We will help you find, and Ms. Toops, all of the disposable funds that we still have in our budgets. I can answer any question about that now, if you wish. Thank you very much.
And thank you both, Philippe and Dave. Just so you could be aware, first of all, I think the information is great. It actually addresses some of the concerns expressed by the member who made the amendment. And so you could understand the process. The amendment was made to make the cut, but it was objected to. So it's going to be addressed thoroughly. Mm-hmm. There is really not any additional action on that amendment that could be taken because that member is, of course, not with us today because of prior business obligations. But I think the presentation is one that could be influencing and whatnot. And I foresee some positive results, but I wanted you to be aware of what can, in fact, be done today. But really good presentation. I know I had the opportunity. I cannot call the gentleman's name, but the ambassador that you all brought down, we were up in the mayor's office at the time. As a matter of fact, with the conference of mayors, I got a photo and with a Mayor Boudreau, and he suggested that I become a Mayor Boudreau myself. And we came up with a Mayor Robidoux, and you know, so we're gonna delay that for a little while, No, the things that you all do are well documented and noticed, and we're going to certainly give it some very, very strong consideration.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Robidoux?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'm not going to comment on Mayor Boudreau. Although I think, you know, and it would probably work quite well at some point. I do want to express my support for International. I think it's important. I think what they do is important, and I understand the needs and the problem we're faced with the parish fund, and I just commit to the council that I'll work with y'all to help figure out the funding that's needed for the other areas. But I do support, you know, Sontra and you know, hope that we can figure out a solution that works for all of the needs of the parish and saves the cut from having to occur at International. Thank you.
Thank you. And I mean, I know just, I think it was last week, we just did some stuff at council meeting dealing with the building for Code of Healing, getting that renovated and up. So,
well, and we have 50 mayors coming in from all over North America this fall. And, you know, none of that stuff would happen were it not for these guys. And so, you know, that's exposure that, it, you know, it's hard to quantify, you know, exactly. But it's got some immediate benefits, obviously, for the amount of folks that are going to be here in town. But then it's got the long-term effects that certainly benefit our community also.
Thank you very much. Okay. We're going to continue our review. We're on page 133, International Trade. Top of 134. Okay, no questions. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Emergency operation and security, page 134.
Mr. Chair, you may note that page 135 is animal control, which has been reviewed already.
Yes, ma'am.
To juvenile detention, 136, which has been reviewed already as well.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
So we will start the middle of page 137.
Yes, ma'am. As indicated, we're going to now go to 137, and this will be human resources.
Mr. Chairman, I mentioned at the beginning of the CAO's division that the allocation method was changed. The allocation method for human resources was not changed and is based on the number of employees.
Okay. Top of 138. 138, Workforce Development Board. Okay, there's no capital. Let's go to the manning tables on 297. Bottom of 297, administration, small business. International trade, top of 298. Emergency operations and security. Hop over to 299, human resources. And Workforce Development Board. Okay. Seeing no questions, any green cards?
Yes, sir, we do. I'd like to start with, we had three citizens who did not wish to speak, who signed in to support the funding of international trade based on the proposed budgeted amount. We do have eight speakers who are signed in to speak with reference to international trade, the first of which is Luis Mora.
Shelter. Yes. Mr. Chairman, ladies, councilmen, mayor, my name is Luis Mora. I've been in Lafayette since 1964. I retired from Exxon after 35 years, and I am the chairman and founder of the Latin Association and the Latin Music Festival. And I've been associated with the International Center for 16 years, and I'm very much aware, and I had worked with them very closely on gamma of things that they do. And I had wanted to let you know that the International Center is probably unique to this city, and you guys should be proud that we have one, and I hope you support it and enhance it. And I had written a letter, a couple of pages, and your secretary's got the copies, and I appreciate it if you take the time to read it. Thank you very much.
Did you submit that to the clerk, or you dropped them to the office?
Dropped them at the office.
Okay. Do you have a copy that you could possibly submit to the clerk for our record? If thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next speaker, please.
Luis German.
As you say, my name is Louis German. I've been in the country for 42 years, living in Lafayette all those 42 years, worked 29 years for Marathon Oil Company. I'm an electrical engineer. And since then, in 1998, I opened my business, LG International Incorporated. I've been working with Phyllis Butani for that long, and I'm a full-time supporter for the business that they create. My business is international business development. I sell product for manufacture and producer in Lafayette, as well make liaison between American company and Latin American company, taking advantage of my Spanish language, make a joint venture between countries. I travel quite a bit to Latin America, and anybody that is open to support the International Center, I would say, please do so. It is a good thing for Lafayette, and it's not just business like mine. It's hotel all the way to taxi cab, because I bring people from Latin America, and we go to their country as well. And the business is doing great. I appreciate any support.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Leslie Hazeltine.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. I'm here to, a lot that I was going to say has already been said by Mr. Domingue and Mr. Gustin, but I'm here to concur with everything that they said and support the International Festival. We started the center started in 1989, and then it was called La Sante, and I was one of the initial board members. At that time, the oil industry was in very bad shape, and here we are again today. What the center did was they just capitalized on all our uniqueness here, and through that grew so many contacts and relationships with our Francophone nations, and our northern neighbors in Canada and Latin America. And out of that, we generated a lot of income for the community. In the last 24 years, we've generated over $78 million in economic impact in this community through hotel rooms, restaurants. We've led and hosted many, many trade missions. And the International Center won the President's E Award, Export and Exporting. And that's a very distinguished award. And another thing that even makes us more unique is we're probably the smallest community in the United States that has an international center. So we are up there with the big boys like Houston and Boston, and people know about us. People know about Lafayette, Louisiana, that we speak French here, and we're a little bit different, a little bit more unique than any other part of the United States. And we love that. It's just such a jewel. And the staff, everybody works so diligently, and they're really all underpaid, because on Saturday mornings I can call the International Center and Philippe picks up the phone because he's there working. And I heard that last Saturday he was in the basement getting the water out. So it's a real jewel, not only for this parish, but, you know, it benefits all of Acadiana, and it just makes our state look really good, and I'm very proud of it, and I hope you take very good care of it, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Harold Lewis.
Good evening, council members. My name is Harold Lewis, Jr. I am an exporter of products and services. Actually, if it wasn't for the Lafayette International Center, I wouldn't have gotten my license to export, mainly to Cuba. We haven't done that yet, but the embargo is on. But the International Center has been real helpful to me. I am a citizen of Lafayette in the Oakbourne community. I've been here about 10 years now since Hurricane Katrina, and I'm a 35-year postal worker, retired. So the Lafayette National Center is a home away from home sometimes for me to get to know a lot of resources that I need to have. And from that point, being associated with it, I got my license through the Department of Commerce, International Commerce, Treasury, and Office of International Foreign Asset Control. So I know those folks real well since moving here. I'm glad I decided to stay, and I'm supporting them 100%. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Scott Feehan.
Hello, council members, Mr. Robidoux, Mr. Dion. Thanks for the opportunity. My name is Scott Feehan, a lifelong resident of Lafayette. Been a business owner here for 18 years. Proudly serving as executive director of Festival International right now. So I met Philippe and his staff last year when I took over, and quickly realized what they do. I have to say, their team is probably our number one resource in this city. Whether it's reaching out to foreign embassies, diplomats, trying to get groups here, working with passports and visas. I can't count the number of foreign diplomats that he's introduced us to and the doors that he's opened us and the resources and the money that aren't available to us otherwise. One project that he invited us to be a part of right now that gets me excited, there's a new nonstop flight from Shanghai to Houston. So Chinese visitors are starting to travel to the southern United States. They're going to be traveling from Houston to Florida. All along I-10, Philippe and his team are working with Ben at LCVC, and like I said, they invited us to the table. We want to make Lafayette a destination for that. We're working on trying to get a Chinese drum and dance group to come in for festival next year, possibly some street animation. Philippe and his team has put us in touch with some resources to try to get funding to make this happen. And what I've seen throughout the years, the way that he works and his team is, not only are we going to, once we do what we do and put the acts on stage and fill the streets, Behind the scenes, what his team's going to be doing is they're reaching out to the diplomats, the embassy in Houston, foreign business leaders. They're going to have people come in from China, reach out to Mr. Shiley Lee and other Chinese business leaders in this area. We're going to get publicity as a city and a parish in China that we couldn't buy. And then behind closed doors, there will be business talks. There will be deals that get done. And I've seen it the last couple of years. It's very important. As a lifelong resident of this area and a business owner, I believe in business. I believe in Lafayette. I believe we have to invest in it. And I think what the work that they're doing is an incredible investment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Mark Zappi. And please forgive me if I'm not saying these names correctly.
Well, you nailed mine. Well, good evening and good to see everybody again. My name is Mark Zappi. I'm Dean of Engineering at UL. I'm also the director of the UL Energy Institute of Louisiana. So we have very strong ties to Philippe and his group. But before I talk about them, I have to say I feel your pain. I've been here a couple hours just listening, and I appreciate the work you're doing. I also appreciate what you're doing with your budget cuts, because welcome to the world of higher ed. We've been doing this for 8 years, so I feel very comfortable and at home here, unfortunately. So good luck. But in higher ed, we recognize it's just some things you can't cut that have too much value. And we focus on the classroom. I think the international office here is just a jewel that just can't afford to be cut. Unlike so many cities in the South, Lafayette is truly an international city, like New Orleans. You just can't afford not to have a healthy and vigorous international office. So I stand here in strong support of what they do and hopeful that they'll be able to keep their money. Because to our community, there's so many aspects that will grow our economy, and the oil industry is international, our cultural entities are international, and don't forget education. If you look at international students across the United States, that's almost a $30 billion industry. And don't underestimate the impact that those students have coming to UL and what they do for our city. More recently, I've had really great experience over the years, but I'll just highlight two events. You might have seen in the paper and on TV, UL has initiated agreements, trade agreements in terms of technology exchange, educational agreements with three states in Mexico. And let me tell you, that would not have happened if it hadn't been for the international office. They are the ones that brought us together. They are the ones that have continued to push us along. And already, numerous companies through that agreement with UL, because UL and higher ed in Louisiana has changed dramatically. What you're seeing is that higher ed and industries have to work together to grow our economy. That's the model. That's the global economy of today. And the international office has been that catalyst for UL and our regional industries to come together and go after this global marketplace that exists. And this Mexican agreement has been a home run. We have an agreement with 22 universities. We'll have all 22 presidents this fall here, I'm sure visiting with you guys. But if it hadn't been for the international office, we would have never gotten off the ground. I just came back from Tabasco. And let me tell you, as we met with the governor's office, the mayor, PMEX, you can go down the list. We had 3 great days of visiting with officials. Everybody told us that Acadiana is their number one target, that we have become their partners. And again, to their credit. Another event that they've been active in is the Vertec conference. I think about a few months ago, some of my students came here, and they won internationally the first place in green city designs. Again, that had Philippe and his wonderful staff's fingerprints all over. They were at Belgium and made a great presentation. That Vertec conference has already brought, we hosted it 2 years ago in Crowley, but there was a lot of activities in Lafayette. That conference brought over 100 attendees from around the world to learn more about our energy resources and our production capacities at Acadiana, not only in oil and petroleum, but also in clean tech or the alternative energy industries, which is going to become a global marketplace as well. So those are 2 really good examples that have had a tremendous impact on our economy. And I'm sure my colleagues, other colleagues at UL, are going to talk about the cultural and musical aspects of it. But I'm hopeful that you guys will be able to find a way to preserve this organization so they won't realize any cuts, because they're a huge asset to our community and region. So thanks a lot, and good luck.
Thank you.
Angela Crean.
Good evening. It is evening now, not afternoon anymore. I'm Angela Kring, the Executive Director of LAGCO, better known as the Louisiana Gulf Coast Oil Exposition. LAGCO is an energy industry nonprofit organization who works year-round to promote commerce, foster education, and connect people within the energy industry. We're best known for the exposition and technical conference held biennially since 1955 right here in Lafayette. In the early 2000s, LAGCO began to expand internationally. Since then, we've grown to host more than 40 countries of international buyers at both our 2013 and 2015 events. Lassant has been instrumental both in the beginning of that international program and currently in sustaining those international efforts. Their staff not only sets up our International Business Center and keeps it running smoothly as we work as a collective throughout the show, but they are a big part of us being an international buyer program show, the first oil and gas show in the U.S. to attain that status, and the only oil and gas show to remain an international buyer program show with the U.S. Department of Commerce continuously since 2003. Together, all of our organizations work together to promote the oil and gas industry and the area of Lafayette to every single oil and gas producing country in the world. In addition to the show itself, Lassant, every year in May, attends the Offshore Technology Conference with us and helps promote both LAGCO and the Acadiana area as an energy service sector hub. Back in June, we co-hosted an event with the U.S. Commercial Service promoting a trade mission in South Africa and Mozambique. That's just the most recent event that we've co-hosted with them. In addition to that event, they've hosted a number of trade missions of Acadiana companies to countries like Mexico and Canada. In 2011, as Leslie told you, they won the President's E Award for Export Services. In 2016, this year, LAGCO was blessed to be the recipient of that award. And I tell you this to say that in working to promote our area as an energy service sector hub, we all stand on each other's shoulders. And without Lassant and the great work that they do, I won't speak for other organizations, although I think everybody here has spoken very well today. I can speak for LAGCO, and I can tell you that we won't be able to reach as high and as far around the globe without Lassant. So we all stand on each other's shoulders, and that's really what makes a big difference for the export community here in Lafayette. And please excuse my voice. I may be going from here to the walk-in clinic, thanks to all the rain. So thank you very much, and we hope that you'll continue to support this great asset in our community. Thank you.
Thank you.
Final speaker, Dr. Jordan Coleman.
Thank you for your time. I'm Dean of Liberal Arts at UL, and I'm also a French and Francophone historian there. I've been in Lafayette for 14 years, and the center, the International Center, has done more during that time, from what I've seen, to promote Lafayette and the surrounding region and all of Acadiana as a destination for cultural tourism in general, and in particular as a destination for cultural tourism and all kinds of cultural activity within the Francophone world. This was first very clear when I began to work with Philippe promoting a French history conference that I organized here. Philippe helped me, and the center helped with logistics for the conference at every step of the way. They didn't spend a penny of taxpayer money on the conference itself. We pulled it all together, but I couldn't have done it without that help. And the effect of this was we brought 200 French historians from universities around the country and around the world to Lafayette. And these are people who are highly trained in French history, but did not think of Lafayette or Acadiana or South Louisiana as part of that. And the center and I together developed a vision of how to communicate to this group of people, thought leaders out there, the amazing things, the amazing heritage, the amazing history that we have to offer here, and how to show them that we are as much a part of French history as many of the other things they teach. The conference was an amazing success. Again, we had 200 people here that had obviously a direct economic impact immediately, but these were also, every single one of them, people who went back to their home institutions and taught hundreds and hundreds of students every year, and included, for the most part, a new vision of this area as having an important part in the culture that they were trying to understand. The center also played a crucial role in the development of two books that were published by our own press at the university just this past year. Both of these books were collections of essays that documented and celebrated the history and culture and importance of the region, its Cajun and Creole cuisine, history, music, these books have reached a very broad audience. One of them has already sold out. The other just came out a few months ago. They have been reviewed in national and international area journals, and they have reached an audience of people, again, opinion makers, people who are in touch with a lot of other people and are beginning to think of Lafayette and Acadiana as the locus of Francophone history and culture in our country. I think nobody disputes the value that that brings in sheer economic terms to our region with cultural tourism, but I think we tend to take it for granted that that's our identity and that people know that because people here know that, but it doesn't come automatically. People around the world don't automatically know to associate Lafayette, Lafayette Parish, or Acadiana with those things. It takes work, it takes dedication, it takes resources, it takes logistics. And over the past 14 years and beyond, the center has done more than any other organization from where I stand to make that a reality through these same means. Final example that comes to mind is our international agreements that the university has been able to forge for the exchange of students and faculty and knowledge across the continents. The center has been crucial in helping us establish relationships with other universities where our students can go and study there. In many cases, our students can go and study at foreign universities, particularly in France, Mexico, as Dean Zappi mentioned, Spain, at no cost to themselves. They pay UL tuition. They can use their TOPS, they can use their scholarships, they can spend a semester or a year studying in these foreign countries. A tremendous benefit. How do you get something like that done? It takes logistics and hard work and people making the connections and hosting the meetings. And the center has been a crucial player in making all of that possible. So in conclusion, I think I agree with all of the previous speakers that we have to do everything that we can, both for the preservation and promotion of our culture and history, and also for our own economic sense, everything that we can to support the International Center. Thank you.
Thank you. Final speaker. Okay. Philippe, you you didn't hold back, huh? good information, though. And as I said, that there will be some significant consideration given, and see how we could make this thing work. Okay, thank you. Now move to the council office.
The allocation method for the council's office was changed from one based on population to one based on non-dedicated ad valorem and sales tax revenue in the city and the parish general fund. Once again, on this chart here, it's not really reflective of the council's budget, because within the council division, you see reserves for new debt service. You'll also see some accounts we call balancing point accounts. So accounts that are increasing in fund balance also show up in the council's, under the council's division. So the number is misleading. The council is not requesting a large increase in their budget. It's pretty much status quo.
Thank you very much. Mrs. Williams?
Yes, sir. I would just like to start off by thanking the staff. Of course, you all know the staff, and of course, it's after 5, so they're not here for me to introduce them. But, you know, the staff goes into overdrive, and this year has really been a hectic year. Of course, we had the inauguration ceremonies with the storm that's going on. They are now planning a police jury Region 3 meeting where 9 parishes will be visiting Lafayette. And with all of that being said, we have our normal work day, and they just don't stop, you know. So I just want to thank the staff for all they do, and acknowledge them, even though they're unable to be here today. And before my budget gets started, I just want to bring to your attention that there are some items in here, especially council member line items, where you will see 100% or so increase in them. Well, that's misleading, because your overall budget line items do not change. What I did is the previous council members did transfers from one line item to another. But what I did is put them back in line. Like, one council member previously might have had tourism line item that went to $10,000, but that council member transferred money from postage, printing, into, say, a tourism line item. So what I did is put them back in line with all council member line items could be basically equal. So, and you'll see that in District 3 and some in District 7, but they are back in line now.
Okay. Thank you very much. We're going to start on page 121. Lori, at the beginning of the budget process, I had spoken with you in relationship to an item, North Lafayette Redevelopment Authority. We identified, we last year I did a budget amendment for some operational dollars as well as some capital dollars. And you identified the operational dollars for me, but we did not find the capital, and I know we was working on that. That would be worked upon, and I think it was put in a worked on. I think it was put in a reserve account. The reason that has now become significant is because the way I proposed it, I remember very vividly, is that those funds would be utilized for matching funds. The authority has been successful this year in the state's budget to secure up to $1 million appropriation. So those funds are going to be very necessary. The North Lafayette Redevelopment Authority is going to be the lead agent in dealing with redevelopment through the adjudicated property process in their specific district that was identified by state legislation. So as we go through this, I'm going to want to try to address that issue, hopefully if we can, if we're ready to do so today at the appropriate place. And if not, of course, definitely by wrap-up. But we've been fortunate in this last state's budget to secure that funding. So this funding, the local funding match, is going to become significant for us. So with that said, again, members, we're on page 21 of the council office. And Mr. Robidoux, just in case you get a feeling you're not able to cut out, but you know. You see something you like in there, leave it alone. Page 122.
Mr. Boudreau?
Yes, ma'am.
On page 122, towards the bottom of the page, the second to last accountant item, 101-1100-77400, reserve operating. That's the $100,000 that was put in reserve for operating expenses for the North Lafayette project that you were talking about.
Okay. Okay. Now, for the capital portion of that, I know that's where I guess we kind of lost something, and I think you had indicated that, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you had indicated, based on the way we did it, something either happened or didn't happen to where it didn't allow it to show up again. Does that make sense to you?
It does, but okay. I think I have a solution for that, except I don't think the dollar amount is what you need. I think you're wanting more money than this.
More money,
but that's
then
on the next page.
Okay. All right, we'll get to it. Let's go to Mrs. Hebert on page 122.
Oh, we already skipped to 142. I guess I just maybe...
I'm sorry, what'd you say?
I didn't realize we've already gotten to 142.
No, no, 22.
Oh, okay. Whew, okay, thought I missed something. But I have a question. Before someone mentioned a past budget department, their number was a lot higher than what they had ever spent, and we asked them why they've been budgeting so high if they never reached that number. Looking at our individual districts, whether it's postage, print, tourism, travel, meetings, I see those numbers are so high, and I obviously can't speak for past board members, but seeing that these numbers are so high, and it doesn't look like last year they came anywhere near that budgeted number, is that something that, if we all felt, we could reduce?
I would certainly say on your own personal line,
okay,
you can in fact reduce it.
Okay.
And I would probably reserve that to each individual member. A lot of these has to do with how you conduct business.
Sure.
As far as what meetings you attend, which you may be a member of, LMA and NLC will kind of dictate that. As far as some of the travel and meeting stuff, like the clerk indicated, some members trained more than others. Some
sure.
members have kind of chosen not to really do anything. The request for service that you see a lot, some districts are much more active than other districts, but certainly anything that you would propose reducing on your own would certainly be in line.
Okay. And Ms. Hebert, you will notice too, District 9 appropriations are half what the other council members' appropriations are, because he made an amendment maybe 3 years ago just to cut his in half.
Well, so since he's not here today, can we just go ahead and cut him anyway? I'm kidding. I kid. And since Jay's here, I want to cut his, too. Okay, nope, that answered my question. Thank
but
you.
But it kind of just depends. What I've seen historically is how some members, I know 1 year I was regional director for the National League of Cities Black Caucus, and it required me to travel a little more. Hosting of conferences, LMA,
sure.
When LMA came, we had a little bit more because we was the host city. So it just kind of depends on the year and what the members' intentions are. For those of us who are members of LPUA, that could create a greater demand.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on what you're able to do. So.
And so if, say, I cut, I don't know, $1,000 out of my travel expenses, because I don't see myself traveling, does the money go back into the general fund? Could I move it somewhere else? Could I? What could I do? I can no, I'm not giving it away to you guys.
Yeah.
giving it to my people, my constituents. Put that on the record. But, I mean, I guess, can you tell me what happened there?
Well, if you cut your budget, it would go back into the city and the parish general fund based on the allocation method that it is allocated by. If you're wanting to move it to another line item, I would say that it probably needs to go to another line item allocated between the city and the parish in the same method. You wouldn't want to move it to something that's allocated 100% to the city or 100% to the parish, because now you just increase the burden to the parish. But you are certainly welcome to reduce your budget and move it elsewhere.
Mike, I asked for more money in the overlay for the city. I couldn't. That's not possible. That kind of moving.
No, this is operating dollars, and you really want to keep your Fund 101 City General Fund operating dollars separate from the 401 City Capital dollars.
Okay.
Because they're a lot smaller amount of operating dollars.
Let me offer you this as well, Liz. Because of the turnover, hopefully you'll be here for, you know.
How many years, Kenneth? How many years?
11
hopefully.
More.
11 yeah. more, gotcha.
10 and a half more. if you do something that becomes reoccurring, because it's operational, so it's more than likely going to go to some type of operational activity that will be continuous, the next member from your district, when that time comes 11 years from now, kind of like, you know, Mr. Robidon, the mayor situation.
Yeah.
that could change.
Okay.
Just from an experience standpoint, about the greater, if you're just looking to do reductions or you want to, you know, minimize expenditure, about the best thing you could offer is say, look, I'm not going to utilize this, I know this in advance, or I don't want to utilize it, and I would rather it go back into the general fund. And it'll just show a lower amount and a lower budget. But to try to allocate it, as far as the moving around, so you could have full understanding, Ms. Williams explained earlier that members in the past, you can move within your own line items. If I've noticed you kind of do a lot of public meetings, and you do, I know you do a lot of social media. Some people have to do postage. They have to do a lot of mail outs. You may have a shortage in your postage, and Ms. Williams could do a budgetary amendment on your behalf that could move $200 or $400 from one of your other line items without having to increase the budget or go into the general fund. So just those are the type of things that typically can be done, and you go from there.
Okay. All right. Thank you. That's all. Thank you, Chairman.
Right. Still on 122. $123.
Mr. Chairman, all the way at the bottom of page 123 is the capital portion of the North Lafayette Regional Development Authority that was set at $50,000. If you
want... Okay, that's 77060?
I'm sorry. Yes, sir. 77060, reserve capital. So it was put into a council's reserve, but it was using Fund 401 capital dollars, and it was set at $50,000. If you're not going to use that this year and this fiscal year without affecting any other accounts, we can reduce the projected amount by $50,000 and move that $50,000 over into fiscal year 16-17. Other than that, if you need more than that, then we'll have to find 401 money that you can either reduce pay-as-you-go projects, or if it is of long-term, something that is applicable where we could use bond money, we can adjust the bond issue.
Well, let's go the simple route first, because another part of that conversation that I remember, if you recall, the question came up, will LCG own this or own that? And I indicated no, you know, it would be... It would be different. So, and I don't recollect how we got to 50, but to keep it simple, so you're telling me if the 15-16 isn't going to be used, we could move that to the 16-17 and it remains at 50?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm going to have to get, well, let's definitely go it on and offer that as an amendment to start. So, is it going to require a zeroing out of that for this year?
I would say we're going to zero out the current budget and the projected both fiscal year 15-16 to zero, and increase proposed 16-17 to 50,000.
I'll do that for now because I'm not prepared to argue and argue my point, of course. And what I'll do is that I'll get with the members from the legislature who was successful in dealing with this, and if a greater match is needed, I just don't want to miss out on that opportunity to pull down to the tune of $1 million through their program, through their bond program. So let's make that amendment to zero out 15-16 current budget, as well as 15-16 projected of 50, and add 50 to 16-17 proposed budget, and that's on line item 40111007706-0 reserve capital.
And there's a couple other entries that go with that budget amendment, so if we can provide you the detail at wrap-up, because actually what it takes that money, rolls it into beginning fund balance, and then next year we're going to use fund balance. Okay. So I'd like to adjust all those accounts appropriately.
Not ready to fully do it now?
Right.
You're going to bring it? Okay, that's fine. I'll have that as a wrap-up item. Yes, ma'am.
So I'm learning to read Connie's mind with her behind me.
Yeah. Still on 123? 124. Page 271, capital. Top of the page of 271. Page 295, Manning Tables. Top of 295. For those members who are new, I like to do this for during budget time. Ms. Williams already have spoken to the excellent job that the staff does under her leadership as clerk, of course, and just the team that has been assembled. You see this staffing, and of course, of those 16 individuals, 9 of those are council members. So you know the balance there. And I'll be just quite direct, is that I always have viewed the council office based on a city our size, a parish our size, the growth that has taken place and the work that they do is understaffed. They do tremendous work with limited personnel. When you look at the type of things that go on out in the communities with projects, and being that the council members are part-time in nature, just having someone representing you or being whether it's meetings, planning meetings for capital projects, things going on here, certainly having a presence in Baton Rouge. Of course, we have folks there kind of looking out for our interests, but there are times when matters specific to council districts are significant. And I like to compare it to New Orleans because I've had the chance to visit New Orleans Council. And New Orleans Council, we have a total staff of 7 people here, and New Orleans council members each individually have a staff of 6 people. And I could tell you that in our budget, because of the presence of the LUS budget within our budget process, we actually manage more money than New Orleans does. Our budget is larger. Certainly not saying that I want to hire 2 or 3 people And to be quite honest with you, my time is coming to an end here. But I think it needs to be something that has to continue to be acknowledged and recognized going forward, because the demand only gets greater. You see what happens with everything from issues dealing with garbage, storm events. You know, people like to deal with the council office. They like to, regardless of what's going on at the administrative level, they like to engage the council. And going forward, I just foresee, especially with the development and growth that takes place, to have boots on the ground. So we're gonna, I would just suggest that members start looking. You know, we are a progressive city. We are a very growing city. We stated our art. We heard a lot of things about the International Center. All of those things don't happen by leaving a component behind. And you don't want to fall behind. And sometimes we hesitate to really look at things thoroughly. And I get that. I understand how we want to be very conservative in nature, but we have to also be careful that we're not so conservative that we start to miss out. So I just wanted to acknowledge that as we look at our manning table, and you have firsthand knowledge now of the work that they do and the production and the turnaround. But look at those numbers. So just keep that in mind for futures, for those of you who will be here well beyond my time here. Okay? Okay. Anything else, Madam Clerk?
No, sir. I'd just like to thank you all for allowing me to be your clerk and to serve in this capacity.
You want to introduce Joseph?
No. As you all know, Joseph is the assistant clerk. He also handles all the RFSs, requests for services in our office, has been a true asset to our office. He came on only 3 years ago when I was hired, I hired him, and he's been a true asset.
Welcome. Look like we got a green card. Mr. Robidoux?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It was pointed out to me that everyone thanked their staff except for me, and so I want to do that. And,
You do that, they walked in here like an A team. I was like, wait,
I still didn't thank them. And Sidra said she's not leaving until I thank her. So I want y'all to be able to lock up. So I went ahead and took care of that. So Sidra, you're free to go. Thank you, Skyron, for being here. But I do want to thank my staff. They were obviously great. And Laurie, thank you for the incredible work that you did with the budget. It certainly makes things a lot easier for all of us.
Yeah. Good. Very good. Okay. Let me announce that there will be a public hearing for citizen input scheduled for next Tuesday, August the 23rd, beginning at 5:30. That will be jointly with our regular council meeting. Members, keep in mind that you do have the opportunity to clear up as much business as possible, and I really, really want to put emphasis on that. The finance department as a whole is about to go into beast mode, trying to get everything prepared and packaged. The council office as a whole has to continue business as has been indicated, and at the same time finish up the budget process. So the more that we could do to clean the plates of these two divisions, these two departments, the better off it is. So please, I respectfully request that you look closely at what you have requested for wrap-up. I request that you look closely at information you have asked for. Check your emails, carry your computers, and if you got it and you're satisfied, remove it. So when they prepare that final document, is going to be as clean as possible with as minimal number of amendments that we need to make. So please engage. Joe has opened up the departments to us. Engage them, get your information, and if we could clean it up before that final process, that'll be great. You want to say something?
Yes, sir. Piggybacking on what you're saying, I did send an email where finance already submitted some of the responses as it relates to some of the wrap-up items. So I think it was a 13-page document, but it responded to like 7 or 8 of already the wrap-up questions. So please do look at your emails, because I am sending these wrap-up responses to you as well.
And don't hesitate for the new folks. If you have a question, we kind of respond mechanically sometimes because it's so much information. If you want to follow up with a question or you're not sure of something we sent because it's the first time you've seen it, please don't hesitate to call.
Right. What was going to happen after wrap-up, you're going to be in receipt of a document that's going to show those things that showed wrap-up, but it's going to also show the general amendments. Okay, as well as those separate amendments that was objected to. And I don't think it was, actually wasn't too bad this year compared to previous years. It wasn't too bad. But again, the more we could clean up, the better. Okay?
And with the productivity of the staff, Joseph just informed me that he has been already sending you the wrap-up list, the separate amendments, and the general amendments. So,
okay. All right, again, thank you all very much. We adjourn. That was too hard.